good evening and bollocks.
Cut!
Plug it in, man. Plug it in, man.
Hey, man, what you doing?
Press
man?
That button there, man, the blue one. Turn it off, man. Oh, man.
Listening to VIZ, the rock and roll years. A program packed full with all your favorite VIZ characters. The House of VIZ editorial team.
My name's Chris Donald. I'm the editor, founder, editor, or proprietor of VIZ magazine.
I'm Simon Donald, co-founder, assistant, sub, under editor. I am Chris's younger brother, which is why we share the same name.
I'm Simon Thorpe. I am one of deputy stroke assistants. Deputy sub, deputy editor.
Member of the editorial cabinet.
I'm Graham Dury, another editorial cabinet member, and I do the same as the other two.
But you're from Nottingham.
Loaded magazine.
No matter when you first discovered VIZ, it was an amazing experience. In the way that VIZ was very much Chris and his friends making a living out of something that they started off in the bedroom, it was in many ways it was a forerunner to Loaded.
That singer out of Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark.
The essential charm of VIZ is that whilst it deals with extremely lowbrow humour, it's incredibly well done. And you know, the bottom line, for now, is that it's funny.
The publisher, John Brown.
It's the thing I most want to read. It's also made a lot of money. I think really it's the sort of ultimate publishing dream.
And top tips from Vic and Bob.
I bet there are occasions when you're sitting down getting ready to do a really big job, but don't know how to get it started. Well, Vic and I can be relied upon to help you out, however big your job is.
First time I picked one up, I think I picked it not up, but down from quite a high shelf in Smith's.
It's a good point, because they used to be kept on the very high shelves at Smith's during the early years. The early years.
VIZ, the early years. The story of Chris Donald and his proud organ begins in the mid-1970s in the classrooms of Heaton Comprehensive School in Newcastle, attended by Chris and his brother Simon, and where Donald Major is frequently bullied.
I found favour with some of the bullies by amusing them and doing cartoons at school. That's people rather than hitting me, they would say, go and draw somebody on the blackboard. Go and draw Mr. Hesketh with his big nose and his nasal hair protruding on the blackboard. Donald, so I would do. And then he would come in and they would say, Sir Donald drew you on the blackboard, and I would get punished. We had an art teacher called Mr. Massey Taylor. He was a Nazi. He was a frightening man. I believe he's dead now, is that right?
Yes, he was a Nazi.
He was the head of the art department. Mr. Dixon was his second in command, who taught us.
Couple of very nice lads. Very dry sense of humour. Very pleasant. They always did what they were told, but they had a slight sense of anarchy, you know.
And Mr. Dixon, like Mr. Massey Taylor, never attended lessons, and so you'd get left to tie that through.
The cartoons tended to creep into their artwork as often as possible, not just their artwork, but in other subjects, any biology work, and any other illustrations in other lessons, and the cartoons would be there. You'd have sort of drawings of figures with exploding heads and things like that, you know, in the cartoons.
I actually built up a huge, vast archive of the cartoons. There was the books that I did at school that were sort of, there was 13 of them, the Fat Crusader books, so called.
I probably said, you know, don't waste your time on cartoons, son, there's no money in it, you know, proved very wrong in the long term.
But as well as that, me and Jim, who I'd met at school, he was a bit of a cartoonist as well, and we used to, like, draw gruesome pictures of, like, huge fat people with no limbs.
Well, Chris and I were doing sort of photocopied single sheets of cartoons and selling them to friends in bars.
Once we'd left school and there wasn't any chance of circulating sort of semi-interesting things around the class, we did these little things, one-page things that we got photocopied, called, there was the Daily Pie, which was the first one, and there was Arnold the Magazine, which was the second one, and we photocopied them, and it cost about 5p to get them copied. And we sold them in the pub for 10p to our friends.
I don't think we thought anybody would go for it, really, but they seemed to like it. And we thought, why not make it a comic?
But they were sort of a cross between, well, they had just the odd funny cartoon, like Tommy's Birthday, which was just a bloke who blew out the candle on his birthday cake, then his head fell off.
The story of the Gosforth Hotel and anti-pop records. After leaving school in 1978, Chris starts work as a CEO in the local branch of a highly secretive government organisation, otherwise known as a clerical officer at the DHSS. To relieve the boredom, Chris and his best mate, Jim Brownlow, frequent the Gosforth Hotel, where they come across an inspirational punk guru by the name of Arthur Two-Stroke, whose real name is Phil, and who runs a small record label called Antipop Records.
That's where I was working at the DHSS. There'd be like loads of people in the office saying, do you want to come and see Blondie? And you'd end up in a row of like six blokes all masturbating in their pants. And they'd be sitting there thinking, not quite for me.
So, was that a metaphorical
thought? Not really, no, it was more sort of physical. But and then Jim suggested we go to the Gosforth Hotel, which was in a hotel in Gosforth. And it was a pub, really, and there was a sort of a punk evening on a Monday night.
Well, it was on a Monday night, Antipop, which was sort of local record label promoters. They'd put on bands there every Monday, and they were usually sort of wild, punky bands, local, just loud, raucous stuff.
It was a copycat two-tone thing, really, because two-tone was a big success in Coventry. But the two Mr. Biggs was Andy Pop, he was called, who was a scruffy bloke who, as my dad described, he said there was a bloke at the door for you earlier, he looked like he had flour on his face.
That's right, I was Andy Pop.
That's Andy Inman.
I was sort of manager. I was the one that did all the business stuff.
He's now in charge of VIZ Distributions Limited, which I handed him on a plate. I said, do you want to take it on? And he said, yes, because that's what he talks like. So he took it on, and within about 2 years, it's a multi-million pound empire to rival my own.
I mean, I know I was a big punk fan, you know, and Chris was. He went for, like, more off-the-wall bands, like the funnier bands, band, you know, people who did it with wit and a bit of humour, like Arthur Two-Stroke.
The guru bloke, he was called Arthur Two-Stroke, and he was the lead singer in Arthur Two-Stroke, and he was also the mastermind behind Antipop. It was his idea.
Well, Arthur Two-Stroke was my cell. I was in a pub with my brother, and this guy came walking in, and he must have been about 70, and he was staggering. And my brother looked across and went, oh, it's Arthur Two-Stroke. And I said, why is that? And he said, he's had two strokes, and his name's Arthur. And it's just kind of stuck in my mind, you know.
And he was quite old. He must have been 10 years older than us at the time. But we thought he was fantastic bloke to watch. He wears suits that were too small, and he used to sing about the wondrously world of Jacques Cousteau and stuff.
And it was sort of tongue-in-cheek, you know. And it became not a hit.
Beginning to
act second. He's just a smuggy old granddad,
man. He is actually.
We were doing it in the same kind of spirit. that other people were doing bands. You know, they were saying, you know, it's easy, just grab a guitar and jump on stage and you can be a band. And we were saying, well, why the hell not? Why can't we do this? You know, it's easy. You just draw a cartoon, take it to a printer and bingo, you've got a comic.
Of Wavis O'Shea. Arthur Two Strokes' anti-pop label promote local Geordie punk musicians at the Gosforth Hotel and have minor success with a local lad by the name of Wavis O'Shea.
Wavis was like a nutcase, really. Well, not a nutcase, he was a genius. And he was a local character from South Shields, and he would do things like walking around with glue pots tied to his head and these like false noses.
Wavis's gimmick was that he wore a large false nose and that he ate fig rolls.
He had a single and an album which we put out, and the album was called Anna Ford's Bum.
It would have been his second album, and it was great. They sent me a tape and asked me to design the record sleeve, and they brought a single out to promote it called You Won't Catch Me on the 503, which is a sort of bus driver country and western music.
I am the bus driver, sonny. You won't get your change. I am the bus driver, sonny. I'll rip you off. I am the bus driver, sonny. You won't get your change.
We went to his house in South Shields, and he was saying how he was making this record called Texican Ravaloni, and he said he was inspired to do it by the Greek god Pan himself, who appeared at his bay window and was half man, half horse beast. And then his mum came in to ask him if we wanted a cup of tea, and he says, "Mom, tell him about the Greek god Pan." And she says, "Oh, he come through the window, he just walked through the window, Rodney." He calls himself Wavis O'Shea and Fofo Spearjig, and he told everyone his real name was Rod Stewart.
The last I saw of him was on Stars in Your Eyes. He was being Steve Hartley out of Cockney Rebel.
I am the bus driver, but if they won't change back, then I will kill them and I'll get the sack. I've had 30 jobs and I've killed quite a few, but when you're psychotic, that's the least you can do. I guess that I'm wicked, I won't get them changed. They can't understand it, they think that I'm strange. I've wrecked 60 buses, yet I'm driving again. If I live my life over, I'd still be the same. Your change from me. Oh, oh, you won't get your change from me.
It's 1979, and Chris, Simon, and Jim are desperate to join the anti-pop gang. But not being musical, they decide to put their talents to producing a cartoon fanzine from the production office, which is Chris's bedroom. Meanwhile, Arthur Two Stroke and Andy Pop are asked to appear on local TV.
They wanted us on Time Tees, you know, old Time Tees wanted us here, so we. Myself and Andy Inman went to Tyne Tees and we did this local youth program thing. We talked about anti-pop and all its, you know, glory. And at the end of the show I said, you know, we're always looking for talent, you know.
We'd been going to the Gosforth Hotel a couple of times and a couple of weeks in a row, and we sort of decided that we'd do a fanzine, because fanzines were the boat.
The next day I was in the office and a knock on the door. And these two young lads came in. And it was Simon Donald and Chris Donald. And he said, "Oh, we saw you on the telly, you know, you're really talented and everything. Can you do a comic?"
And there would be Andy sitting behind the desk answering the phone and with money literally sticking out of his pockets. And Phil would be sitting on the radiator next to the window and he would go, "Guana, guana, guana," several times, trying to inspire himself to think of something.
I read through the comic and it was good. There were swear words in it, and there was, like, you know, nice comedy violence and that. I thought, everybody's got fanzines, you know, and we haven't got one. You know, we need a fanzine for our record company. And I said, well, listen, I've got no money, but, you know, come in with us and, you know, I'll help you all I can. Make a comic, we'll sell it at the gigs. And that's how it started, really.
So we were in their gang. They'd accepted us into their gang. In them days, Arthur Two Stroke, and then he recruited an eight-piece band in the end, and he renamed them Arthur Two Stroke and the Chart Commandos, and they had a big brass section and stuff. They came before Bad Manners and before Dexys and all that sort of thing, but everyone else just beat them to it as usual. But they were doing this big sort of brassy sort of sound around the clubs in Newcastle, and they had Hawaii Five-O was their big cult single in Newcastle.
Country club, and Steve, the trumpet player, was on the stage doing a sound check, and he started blasting out Hawaii Five-O, and we all liked it, you know. So, you know, next rehearsal we'd learn Hawaii Five-O, and of course, like, it used to go down a storm.
We'd regularly go down and see them at clubs and see Chris Waddle dancing on tables to Hawaii Five-O at 2 o'clock in the morning when there was a home game on the next day, and that's true.
Oh yes, Chris used to come to all the club gigs. And he used to come moaning and groaning about he'd been told off for this, that and the other. And he said, Arthur, I just want to be a star like ye. I want a gun on this stage. I said, but listen, Chrissy, man, you are a star, you know. You've got a full supporting cast, you know, Kevin Keegan, Terry McDermott. Just keep your nose to the grindstone and you'll get somewhere. I thought, well, listen, it's an instrumental, you know, so I'm not in it. So I had to write a rap for the middle of it.
The first gig we ever sold them at was one at the Gosforth Hotel, and I think we took about 40 to start with.
Chris and Jim Brown, though, just turned up, and they came to me, and I was sitting at by a table at the door, you know, taking up these 30 minutes. And he said, do you mind if I go in and sell these comics?
We didn't sell any for a while, I was just stood there, and it was phenomenally expensive, you have to remember, because it was 20p.
And I said, well, let's have a look at one, and I looked at it, you know, and guffawed a bit. I don't know whether I've made it up, you know, it's a long time ago now, or whether it is true, but I always tell everybody anyway. I bought the very first copy.
Vic, I can't help noticing how clean and shiny your tools are, but whenever I do any hoeing or digging or ploughing, mine get covered in limestone, earth and loam. How do you keep yours so spick and span?
It's easy, Bob. Whenever I need to work in the garden, I simply borrow my neighbour's tools, thus keeping mine in pristine and untarnished state.
You do have lovely tools.
Thank you.
The VIZ Top 10.
Andy Inman, when he was bringing out Arthur Tucson records like Y50, he would send us, both of us, off to different record shops in town, armed with money, and tell us to buy 6 copies of the Arthur Tucson singles every day for a week, and they all looked at you funny. And sure enough, he managed to hype the record into like the Evening Chronicle Pop 50 or whatever it's called. It was probably out of sour grapes because the Chart Commandos and Arthur Tucson had never had a hit. We believed that the charts were all sort of payola and corrupt, and you had to buy success in the charts. So we decided to just make a top 10 chart, which was completely corrupt, and your placing was based entirely on how much money you sent us in. And if you sent 50 quid, that was the largest amount we received in that issue, then you were number one. mostly sort of crap independent record, and we just got fed up listening to them. But one day I chucked one on the record player because I recognised the song title. It was the Pinball Wizard, and the bloke was called Saint Andrew. Issue one of our new magazine. Yeah. It was just a one-off thing that we were doing for a bit of a laugh.
People would get hold of it at college and they'd take it home, and their younger brothers and sisters would see it and they would get into schools and stuff like that.
Then what would happen was one or two people would buy one, and they would then go off and they would be with a group of, say, 10 other people. And before you knew it, all of their mates would come back and they would start asking for copies for their friends as well.
I think we were so sick of trying to decide on a name for it.
And we didn't really have any plans to do a second one. Until the first one sold out and people started laughing at it.
First one was, it must have come out around Christmas, because it was called the Bumper Monster Christmas Special. But it wasn't actually called Viz Comic then. Chris just thought it up out of nowhere.
That was a point at which it became like an ongoing thing, you know, we were going to print a second one.
Chris always wanted to make a living out of it.
There was one girl called Ruth, and she says, "You capitalist." And I just went, "Oh, thank you very much, man. Bastard." I was walking home from town past Barras Bridge and past the Civic Centre, and the card bar had just started selling issue number 2. And as I walked past, there was this group of kids on the grass outside the Civic Centre, all lying there reading it and laughing at it. And I got a big buzz now. They're reading my comic.
The story of Brian Sandals and the card bar. Word spreads quickly in the pubs and bars of Newcastle, and soon Brian Sandals becomes the first shopkeeper in the universe to sell Viz Comic in his tat emporium, the Card Bar.
Card Bar, it was a tat emporium. Brian Sandals, who'd been there since the 60s, I suppose, he had about 4 shops in a row, and it was all, he'd sell posters in one. And he had, he'd just get any sort of tat there, really. He didn't care what he sold.
There's no way that I would strictly call it crap.
Yeah, that's his spin. He says, "Oh, no, it's not." He says, "It's not." But it is.
At that time, we'd had a lot of people in with various different productions that they'd produced on their own, and really they were so amateurish, but Viz just stuck out as being well designed, and it was obviously put together by someone who knew what he was doing.
He was a godfather to us, because he'd go in and like he would just give you advice non-stop. If you went in just to deliver 20 comics, he'd put them on the counter and then he'd give you like half an hour of advice which he'd accrued.
During which you'd begin to question his sexuality in your mind.
Well, a little bit. No, he was just fatherly. He was all full of advice.
The circulation went up and up, and I think when they were printing 10,000, we were selling roughly 8,000 copies.
The Big Break. It's 1981. Chris, Simon and Jim are invited to take part in a trendy youth programme on BBC Two called Something Else.
The BBC were making this alternative programme for youth people.
We did that thing for the BBC. Something else.
And they came up to Newcastle and the idea was that they got six kids or youths to like, or people to direct and make the programme.
I seem to remember I was wearing like dark glasses and a wig and stuff like that.
It was our first sort of meeting with the media. We weren't quite sure how to handle it. So we decided to go to the Brambling and get pissed.
We decided that the catchphrase was going to be we were trying to create an environment in which common sense can prevail.
Yeah, it was the BBC 2 Community Programme Unit.
Very well, by young people,
for young people.
So we begin this evening on BBC 2 with the new series of the programmes made by and for young people in search of something else.
Message is VIZ coming, trying to say something.
Trying to create an environment in which common sense can prevail.
We're making society sort of a nicer place to live in, you know? And like, make sort of life a better thing to live, you know? That's what I'd say. How about you, Chris?
I'll go on with that, yeah.
Yeah.
Despite this performance, the interview is still broadcast, which leads to a phone call from IPC, Britain's largest magazine publisher.
We did that programme and then we did another one called Sparks, which was exactly the same thing. And I got a phone call off a man called Bob Painter at IPC. He looks just like Liberace. Is it Liberace? He looks incredibly like Liberace.
Yeah.
But he's not. He's actually the editor of Buster and stuff like that, managing editor of IPC's youth group. And he rang up and he was all sort of coy on the phone. And he said he'd seen the comic on the telly and he was interested in talking to us, or his managing directors at IPC were, did we want to come down to London? Well, it was practically, literally, quite literally, probably the first time I'd been to London. When we got off the train at King's Cross, the Green Cross code man was on the platform.
Dave Crouse.
When there is no traffic coming, across, looking and listening as you cross.
He was Darth Vader in Star Wars, and he was cross because they didn't use his voice, and he talks like that.
I was very disappointed.
So he's James Earl Jones instead.
Meanwhile, back at the meeting.
It was in the penthouse suite or something at Kingsreach Tower, and there were butlers and waiters and God knows what supplying us with large amounts of drink.
Yeah. Well, they had a great big boardroom table and they put the three of us on one side and then they had six of them on the other side, so we were facing them. And but before dinner, we had drinks and we had to like look out over London. And for like pre-dinner chat, one of them came up to me and he pointed out the headquarters of the International Monetary Fund. And that's what I thought about International Monetary and stuff.
They wanted us to do a dummy of a comic for them, which they made a real mess of and sent it back, so this is the way we want to do it.
They must have sent it to a comedy expert who had a red pen.
Comedy analysis.
Because it was looked at by a comedy expert and then sent back to us in a box, and what they'd done was they'd stuck bits in. They kept saying it, we want it to be a little bit more political, we want it to be political, they wanted it to be sort of satirical and political.
And we just said no.
First time anyone had got their hands on our stuff and sort of
metaphorical terms, they were buggering our kids.
Abby was like, Raj. And it was about 6 months later. And he says, I'm afraid, he says, we've decided that you're right, it is funnier the way you suggest it should be. However, we couldn't possibly, IPC, a company with our reputation, couldn't possibly publish a magazine like that. That sort of scurrilous type of thing. And he tipped me the wink. He says, but I'll tell you what, he says, you want to try Richard Branson, because he's, apparently, he said he's looking for a sort of youth magazine to publish. So I says, all right then. So I put the phone down and I went and wrote a letter to Richard Branson. I didn't realise at the time, I thought Richard Branson just sat there in an office and he did everything, but he has all these different companies, so he probably never saw it. It got sent to Virgin Books, which was his publishing company, and John Brown was the managing director of them.
The story of John Brown, the publisher.
My name's John Brown. I'm the publisher of Viz. Have been since about 1985.
He's the sort of person who, if he'd been in your class at school, like, not that I'd have got anywhere near Westminster School, but if I'd been in his class at school, I'd have probably hung around him.
I was ill one day, and watching one of those remarkably dull sort of daytime BBC programmes, although I'm sure they're much better now, and I just looked up, and there was this strange little piece about this comedy team in Newcastle doing a magazine.
Try to create an environment in which common sense can prevail.
And they were wearing white coats.
He sees himself as being an absolute shark of a businessman and shit hot, but really he's just a sensitive little boy with big feet.
And I remember just thinking, oh, I'd better get hold of a copy of that. But about 3 weeks later, a copy landed on my desk at Virgin. Read it there and then, and really didn't sit down. I mean, I just went straight into my then boss's office and said, I want to publish this.
He rang up and he said, I'll come up and see you tomorrow, which was quite impressive.
And I went up to Newcastle, I think about 2 days later.
But only flew to Middlesbrough.
I went to a place called Teesside. It sounded pretty close to me. But I mean, it is fairly close, isn't it?
And then he got in a taxi outside Teesside Airport and said, Lily Crescent, Jesmond, please. And the taxi driver said, is that in Newcastle? And he went, yeah. He said, I'll tell you what, I'll take you to the station. You can get a train to Newcastle.
It took about a day and a half to get there. But, I mean, I went to see them, and basically we just agreed that I would do the business and they would do the creating. I said all I wanted to do was make it come out regularly. No.
And we do have this sort of Sheriff of Nottingham, Robin Hood sort of relationship.
He says that the others look upon me as the Sheriff of Nottingham.
Whereby he's the Sheriff of Nottingham and I'm Robin Hood and his merry men.
The cad.
He's the capitalist down there in London, we're not.
The last issue they published sold about 4,000 copies. That issue, I think, sold 9,000. Then when I started up my own company, which was in April 87, it was selling 22,000. So it went from 4 to 9 to 22 in about, you know, a good 2 years.
We just do the comic for the fun of it.
I mean, I think he's a... I think he's a genius. I mean, I think he's the only genius I personally know well. Because he has the surest touch in the world. I mean, there is never a word wrong in Viz. It never, ever, you know, isn't off the middle of the bat.
Here's another top tip. Radio 1 producers, don't let your listeners forget what they're listening to. Get an announcer to say something exciting like,
you're listening to Viz, the rock and roll years, on Radio 1.
About halfway through. And if your listeners have tuned in especially to listen to the Val Doonican story, then you know you've cleverly informed them that they've tuned in 1 week too early.
It's 1984. The Viz team swells to a massive four when Chris and Simon Donald are joined by Simon Thorpe and Graham Jury. Jim Brownlow, meanwhile, who has been responsible for the legendary Paul Wicker, the tall vicar, gets himself a job as a builder and leaves the Viz team.
Jim's never actually left.
Okay, Jim Brownlow never actually left.
There's a lot of things going on in my life that meant I couldn't devote a lot of time to it. Like, my father got ill, and died.
He's just did cartoons freelance and on a sort of gradually decreasing scale.
If I'd been prepared to work my balls off like Chris and Simon and later Simon and Graham, if I was prepared to have done that, yeah, I could have made a lot more money than I did out of it, but I just wasn't prepared to do that, and I'm not sorry in any way about that.
I mean, Paul Wicker, the tall vicar, even though he's not appeared now for probably 10 years or something, remains one of the most popular characters in the comic.
The year is 1985, and Viz is officially branded as not as funny as it used to be.
I think issue 13 was out, and Mark E. Smith out of The Fall, who was obviously hip to the jive, Dalio, he had his ear to the ground, and he'd heard that we'd sort of sold out and had a publishing deal now. So in an interview, I think it might have been Alphabet Soup it was in or something like that, but it was definitely a fanzine what I'd read, and he said that Viz have sold out and it's not as funny as it used to be anymore. And little did I realise at the time that everybody was going to be saying that soon.
It is as funny as it used to be. I saw one about 2 years ago. I walked into the newsagent by where we work at Loaded, and there was this headline on the front page of Viz on the counter next to the Evening Standard and Time Out, and it said Prince Charles's cock. And you look at it closely, and it was even better. It said, I've seen Prince Charles's cock, and it's not much to shout about, says BBC Bog Cleaner.
There was a great Manchester-Newcastle rivalry we used to have, because or somebody out of the Fall thought we, you're a dictionary of names. What's the bloody...
Any other person out of the Fall? No. Oh, there's Mark Riley.
Mark Riley, who then went into Mark Riley and the Creepers. He had a band and called Mark Riley and the Creepers, but they launched a comic in Manchester. Now, that was funny, because they launched a thing called Oink, and it was all about pigs, and it was a sort of adult comic, but for kids. And IPC actually patronised that. They funded it, and they launched it. And there was a great rivalry between us about 1983, and me and my now wife and our photographer, Colin, and James Brown, who's lately uploaded, and we went to their launch party.
And there was a dreadful incident when Chris Donald and I, and Chris's girlfriend, now his wife, we visited the launch.
You're not going to declare the big one, you know?
Yes.
Has he told you about this?
No, well, we stole Oink's cake.
We got really drunk and we stole the Oink cake in an incident of intercomic terrorism.
Steal that cake, because my mother was in tears. You ruined the party. I thought, bloody hell, you're not going to last long in the comic business.
I think he grasped me up in the letters page of Viz.
Viz, letterbox.
I'm Andy McCluskey from the band Orchestral Maneuvers in the Dark. Ah, yes, the infamous series of letters in Viz.
Did you used to know someone famous? Write in.
I don't know how it started, but it was probably, do you know anything about somebody famous kind of thing. And somebody wrote in to say that Paul Humphrey's out of OMD. He's a wanker, I know, and he used to keep his porno magazines under the floorboards. And then next issue had, I don't know Paul Humphrey's, but that Andy McCluskey, I went to school with him, and he's definitely a wanker. This is getting very hard for me. Another one that was from my ex-girlfriend in my teenage years, something about... I had a small prick, or at least 1,000 of them. I had a cactus collection. So, I did have a cactus collection. And I thought, well, what do you do? Do you complain? You go, no. You say, I know what I'll do. I'll write in and confirm it. That'll be a twist to the story. So, I wrote in. I mean, as a Viz reader, I was quite chuffed to have my letter printed.
The Fat Slags and the Story of the Big Market.
John Brown, that great man John Brown, he actually rang me at home on a Sunday morning and he was all excited, and I thought somebody offered him £100 million for the magazine or something, but no, it was better than that. He'd had this great idea. Why don't the Fat Slags release Summer Holiday?
Hey Sam, do you fancy a summer holiday? No, I fancy a bag of chips, mate.
And I thought, well, what a stupid idea, I said.
We're all going on a summer holiday. No more working for a week or two.
And it was a shambolic record. Absolutely shambolic.
And a lot of people believe that the Fat Slags are very much a Newcastle thing, but they're really a creation of Graham Thorpe, who are of Nottingham and Leeds.
We originally created them all in the one room, and when I was thinking of Fat Slags from the Big Market.
Oh, boy,
it used to be a market where people would bring their wares, and it's the sort of centre around which the nightlife all evolves and revolves in Newcastle.
If you look at Sid the Sexist and the Fat Slags, I mean, you go into town any Saturday night, they're there, these characters are there in the town, you know, you see them, I mean, they do exist, and what they've done is just put them down.
You go down the Big Market on a Saturday night and you'll see Biffa Bacon, Sid the Sexist and Fat Slags just in one bar.
You see so many of them about, they're just so true to life. Every bar you go into, you see the Fat Slags, you see Sid the Sexist, Biffa Bacon, I've just seen a Biffa Bacon fighting over there before.
I started doing the Fat Slags. I thought, people will never wear this. This is really sexist. But the reaction it gets from women is amazing. They think it's really funny. A lot of women think it's really funny.
The Fat Slags, yeah.
What do you like about them?
Because they resemble me. A lot of people down south read the Viz, they like it.
Yeah.
I used to be seeing a Cockney and he thought it was brilliant. You've seen them, they come up here and they're like on their bus trips and they think it's the best place to go drinking.
It's actually true to life. It's not, you know, it's not something conjured up out of somewhere to belittle a certain group of people, you know. It actually exists. I've seen them. I've seen Biffa Bacon's mum getting out of a taxi, you know. This woman was 20 stone and she had hairy legs and muscles in her spit, you know. They exist.
The Fat Slags work terrifically well in context. Anyone who's got half a brain realises they are not exploitative, you know, that they do the exploiting. I mean, Sid the Sexist has probably done more against sexism than any sort of national or women's campaign could ever hope to achieve.
Oh, I fancy Nathan Donovan.
Hey, hey, hey.
Absolutely shambolic.
Did you learn any lesson from that?
Well,
probably not.
Nah. You don't, you see, you don't.
We never will learn that.
No, well, we've got to have a hit record. We just have to, it's in our blood.
Bus to go.
Yeah.
Oh, I remember turning up one Friday night at Chris's house. He says, "Listen to this. This is all your fault." And he put this song on, and it was it Andy Partridge?
It was Andy Partridge out of XTC and John Otway doing the vocals. And they're down in Swindon where they had a studio or something. They just off their own bat recorded this record and sent it up and said, "Do you want to release this as a single?" I think they said. And we thought, "Oh, get in. We'll have a hit record." And it was called Bags of Fun with Buster. And the band called themselves
Johnny Japes and his Gesticles.
Who's that dragging what looks like a pink sack of spanners down the road? His swollen folly on a supermarket trolley to alleviate the load. Testicular tomfoolery. It's to the rescue of humanity. And it looks a lot of balls to me. And it's fun and James and Mary Rollocks with Buster Gonads on Bulbasaur. Bags of fun with a Buster and his super scrote or cluster.
Flom.
Watch out for that revolving door. Especially since you dragged them through that powerful cleaning agent someone spilled upon the floor. Oh, Buster, why do you let your sack swing solo? Sack swing solo? Yeah.
A lot of the cartoons were completely fabricated around a name. You'd think of a name and then do a really stupid cartoon to match the name. The local paper here described it as the dandy for grown-ups.
Bed for cobblers, arms and nuts for police.
Look, I don't care what your name is, you're not bringing them on my bus, so off it.
Nobody actually says the word bollocks. Ooh.
The story of Roger Melly, the man on the telly.
TV beckons again as the gang are invited on to Check It Out, another youth TV show from Tyne Tees TV.
Check It Out was like a youth programme on Tyne Tees local telly that we got on a couple of times. And I don't know if we were auditioning for Check It Out or something, I can't remember. But in the background, all you could hear was this swearing.
Bollocks.
I couldn't believe it because it was a dead familiar voice, and it was the man who used to be the, he's not an anchor man, well, I suppose he was an anchor man, he's more of a continuity announcer on Tyne Tees Children's TV. And it was unbelievable to see, like, a TV presenter swearing and using, like, normal language and telling rude stories and stuff like normal people do. So we done Roger Melly.
Look at the link. Like a
Hello, good evening, and welcome to a very special Christmas edition of Blinkety Blank. My mother-in-law, she's a right f***ing bitch.
Catch! Just Roger Melly. Roger Melly's sitting there and finally getting the chat show with the society lady and the vicar, right? And then Ted, or whoever it is, the producer, can't believe it's going so well. And the last box, he just looks up and there's a trail of piss coming down out his pants.
Athena were the first people to sort of accept it as part of the norm by putting in all windows. You know, they had Roger Melly in all their window displays. And they had about 200 shops, and they had archbishops writing to them and saying, yeah, it's disgusting. And the archbishop had a good point, because, you know, 9 years ago, there's no way you could say fart in a newspaper or anything. And I think they've definitely broken down borders. Definitely, you know, you can get away with all sorts of things now that you couldn't do only 8 years ago.
Legacy of VIZ is like around us everywhere at the moment, you know, there's all sorts of stuff that's influenced by it. In publishing, I think, like Loaded magazine, it's not got a lot of VIZ in it, but it's got a lot of that same irreverent attitude.
In many ways, it was a forerunner to Loaded. I mean, some of my favourite things, like the Mark Radcliffe show on Radio 1, or Vic Reeves and Bob Mortimer, certainly Loaded. Although you don't see a direct influence, I'm pretty sure that those sort of people, and including ourselves, wouldn't be felt confident enough to go out and pursue the type of magazine or radio show or anything if they hadn't seen things like VIZ.
Stuff like Vic and Bob, I really don't know whether they were influenced by it, but it's just a real similar kind of off-the-wall humour.
I mean, when you first time you saw it, it was, you know, fantastic. I was shown it by... I'm eating fish. I was shown it by a friend, and I literally could not believe what I was reading.
I could not believe the language.
But, you know, Biff or Bacon... I laughed at Johnny Fart Pants heartily. Fantastic, those big underpants.
Yeah, I liked Black Bag. That was my favourite, and I always was a fan of the chips.
Do you know, Vic, my vegetarian friends are always telling me that soya, bean curd and other microproteins are indistinguishable from meat when used in hot pots and casseroles. So do you know what I do?
No, but what?
Whenever veggies come around to my house for a meal, I give them an inexpensive cut of meat like liver, raisin steak, you know, and sure enough, they never ever taste the difference.
Condemned by their own mouths.
It's 1990 and sales are rocketing up and up. Chris Donald's Swelling Organ has now achieved its full erection by becoming Britain's fourth best-selling magazine, just behind the Radio and TV Times and the Reader's Digest.
We got our sales up to, they suddenly went stupid. They went up like 160,000, 250,000.
Went from 60 to 500 in a year, didn't
they? They were going absolutely haywire.
It got gobsmacking when Chris said, we're selling a million copies of this issue.
We overtook Punch and we overtook NME and we overtook Private Eye and we thought, where's this all going to end?
For a long time, we were very fashionable. And so we were bought because we were very funny, but we were also very hip.
Then when it got to a million, it was like we were in cloud cuckoo land sales-wise. It was ridiculous, and nobody could believe it except John, who thought it would last forever.
All of us knew that there was a natural life. A natural sales up and down.
The VIZ team are honoured by an invitation to the Grosvenor House Hotel in London to attend the prestigious Advertising Awards.
We got invited because it was all posh, so we went down. There was like a circulation award was one of, was one of the
awards.
We've
got to have a chance at that, yeah. Best circulation.
So anyway, then it came to the announcement of who'd won, and John was at our hotel and he started getting upset. Because we were already up on our feet cheering when they started to announce the awards. And they said, and the winner is...
The winner is... Auto Express!
And we went, what? And the next thing we were all up on our feet shouting, you're f***ers, right? And this is in the middle of this really posh do, you know? So John went light like he was having kids. He went, sit down, you bloody fools! Sit down, you fools! You ruined my reputation!
Competition page.
You know, there wasn't a whole load of magazines came out. There wasn't a scene that created those magazines. It was just Chris and his brother and his mates.
It was phenomenal. But a lot of publishers spotted it and thought, oh, there's obviously a market here. And we basically worked our bollocks off to get into the, like Private Eye did before us, to get into WH Smith's and that. They wouldn't sell it for ages, and eventually we got a slot on all the newsagents' shelves. And then once that slot was there, and they decided to call it Adult Comics, and then all these other magazines came on and says, alright, we'll have a place on that shelf. And so they just had to churn out anything.
A few of them are still about, you know, Zit or Top Banana or whatever, but there's loads of them. You know, it must have been about 8 or 9 at one time. But they all missed the point.
But there was one from Brighton, they tried to, like, wind us up. I'll not even repeat the name.
I'm Andy Willard, editor of Zit Comic. Initially, we did jump on the bandwagon, but I don't think we were ever, ever, ever going to be a threat to Viz at all. Everything that Viz does, they do absolutely perfectly. But we're a bit crap.
We are just the right side of the fence, but very firmly just the right side. They are remorselessly the wrong side.
Yeah, we're on the wrong side of it, if there is a wrong side of it. I've got a tremendous amount of respect for what they're doing. I always have had, and you know, I always will.
We're a butterfly fluttering around the meadow of comedy gaily, stopping from flower to flower, and they're like a sort of a man-made contraption with like 8 wings that you see in black and white crashing at the end of the runway because they're trying to replicate it, but they don't know like what the formula is or what the purpose of it all is.
I don't think one can describe why something's funny. The simple answer is it's funny because of the four creators. As to why technically it's funny, I wouldn't dream to attempt to sort of work out, but characters that are half fish, half goalkeeper are brilliant in their own right.
Young Billy Thompson was determined to make it as a pro footballer despite being born half man, half fish.
Every comic had a boring football strip, so we put a boring football strip in.
They all had a boring football strip with a ridiculous gimmick involved.
One fine day at the local park...
Hiya, I'm Billy Thompson. Any chance of a game? OK, Billy, you can go and go.
I just invented a bloke who was half man, half fish who could swim through the air.
Great save, kid. What a keeper.
I hit that one like a bullet. How he stop it? After the game...
Hiya, kid. I'm Tommy Brown, manager of Fulchester United. You had a good game. How'd you like to sign up with us?
Gosh, a chance to play for United.
We decided to do a football single because Phil, who was Arthur Two-Stroke, he was hanging around with nothing to do, so we said, do you want to do a football single?
Well, I knew everything about Billy the Fish, so I just wrote a song and made it as football-y as possible, you know. And I rather like the idea of having that the Annie song in it. Da, how does it go now?
You fill up my senses like a night in a forest.
Got in touch with John Denver, you know, and apparently he was flying his plane or something over the Washington Gorge when they got hold of him. And the thing is, I'd already made the song, right? I'd written the song and recorded it. He didn't like it at all. He thought it was sacrilegious, his lovely song and that. So then I was a bit stuck because they were asking me to send down a master tape now, right? But John Denver didn't want to know. So I went back in the studio, just changed the melody. That's all I had to do. Instead of going... I went... And so they then got away with it.
Hello, Jackie and Glenn, the football men. Here we are at Fulchester Studios. What's going to happen next?
We're all going to sing along.
Peaks and the troughs, yeah. And if you're fashionable one year, you'll be unfashionable the next year, and stuff like that.
I think part of the problem is that when it kind of drooped a bit,
for now,
it was because they were so successful.
We were bought because we were very funny, but we were also very hip. Like, you know, there used to be a time when you would stay in to watch Blackadder. Blackadder's still incredibly funny, but you would no longer stay in to watch it. And the same thing happened to Viz. It stopped being fashionable, and we're still bought by a lot of people who used to buy us a long time ago, but now they buy two or three or four copies a year rather than six.
When VIZ sales started to go down, he thought that he was doing something wrong, and that he carried out market research and that to try and find out where he was going wrong and how we could improve it. Because really, John was great as a publisher while the sales were going up. It's once they started to go down, there's cracks occasionally appear when he tries to do things.
But it has generated millions of pounds for a lot of people. I mean, certainly for... and that's not all profit, but it's generated it. It's made a lot of money for Chris, it's made a lot of money for me, it's made quite a lot of money for the contributors, the other three editors.
A lot of people say, oh, you're a complete idiot, you know, you could be a millionaire now and all that stuff. And like, one, I couldn't be a millionaire because I would have spent it all anyway. And two, I'd probably be dead, you know, if I'd made that much money.
But basically, all John has to do is keep paying the printing bill, and when anyone rings up and says, shall we do a Fat Slags record, he has to say, f*** off.
Even 10 years ago, people have thought he's only got 1 year left, or people are going to see there's only one joke, and it'll, you know, they'll get used to it.
Chris told me about 5 years ago that he didn't really want to do it anymore, and that the other guys in the team said, well, you know, it's all right for you, you've made all the cash, but this is our job. And, but you could sort of see that tiredness creeping in, and but then they turn that on their head, and once again it's very funny.
Get out the way! Get out the bloody way! Go on, get out of it!
Ravy Davey definitely struck a chord, hasn't he?
Get out the bloody way!
I thought that was very funny when he was dancing to the drills.
Say, how long can the comic go on? I believe 5 years ago I was quoted as saying another 2 years would be all I could manage.
I've been signing on 3 years.
The thing is, who knows what, it could all end suddenly. We had a bomb scare in our offices not long ago. It turned out to be strawberries. It was a punnet of strawberries that one of the insurance people upstairs had quite sensibly notified the bomb squad about.
If I bought one magazine at all, it's what I would buy. I mean, it really is, genuinely. It would be, if somebody said you can only buy one magazine, it would be VIZ. So it's the thing I most want to read. It's also made a lot of money. And it's something I'm enormously proud of as well. So I think really it's the sort of ultimate publishing dream.
In this country, they've sold more units than U2. They've got more money through retail than U2 have. And, you know, U2 are the biggest rock band in the world. And in this country where their humour is valid, they're much more successful.
The thing with VIZ is that it's often been overlooked as to how much it's changed comedy and how many boundaries it really kind of knocked down, how many walls it knocked down, how many boundaries it went beyond, how much it changed. It hasn't been given the same credit things like Monty Python or the young ones have.
It's my kind of sense of humour. It's still in the spirit of what Chris and I had in common when we first met, which was like a sense of humour.
The funny thing is, as thought we, I think, originally pointed out, the 100th issue will be the first one of the year 2000. And it would be a shame not to do that one, just to see what it's like having issue 100. It would have to be silver, and that would be in the year 2000. That would be fantastic. Although Thorpe came to work the other day, and while we were having our coffee and our chat in the morning, he pointed out that it's not a question of whether the Earth will be hit by an asteroid, it's a question of when the Earth will be hit by an asteroid. So who knows, that might bring VIZ to an abrupt halt.
And so, 18 years after its birth, we come to the end of the story of Chris Donald and his once proud but now slightly shriveled organ. VIZ the Rock and Roll Years was narrated by me, Dan Friedman, and was produced by Julian Mayers. No part of this programme can be reproduced or transmitted or brought back to life using the energy of a thunderstorm or killed with a wooden stake, etc., etc., blah, blah, blah.